Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. My name is Raymond Bruce Birkett III. It's nice to be here. Thank you for coming. I'd like to start by saying hello, but I already said good evening, so that's right out of the window. So you believe this one we're having? Because I do not. It's a myth. It's a conspiracy made up by the government. Just like the moon landing. That's nonsense. We landed on the moon. Most conspiracy nuts are nuts. That's why it's right on the name there. Conspiracy nuts. When someone starts telling me a crazy conspiracy, what I like to do is agree with them and say, yeah, that's right. And JFK, shout yourself. So I'm using the set list tonight. That wasn't on the set list. But I figured I'd look at it and explain that I'm using a set list because I have crazy hours. Oh, man. Yes. Alright, so that's my set list. When I was a little kid, I used to dream that one day I would grow up to be 6 foot tall and wear glasses. I am nearsighted, so I need these glasses. I'm not one of those lame people who's just wearing non-prescription glasses trying to look cool, or one of those stupid people that's like, oh, I'm wearing my grandpa's glasses. I'm like, doesn't that hurt your eyes? I'm like, yeah. I'm like, well, you're destroying your eyes. And that's not going to be cool because you're a moron. So anyway, I need these glasses. And I think they're cool. And I'm 6 foot one. I used to be 6 foot one and a half, but hard labor and time has shortened me by half an inch. It happens. At any rate, my point is, I exceeded my dreams by an inch. And I didn't even have to try. At one point, it was an inch and a half. But I lost it, so dreams do fade away at some point in time if you live long enough. I'm a classy guy. I drink a lot of tea. That's how I qualify being classy. So I have fine china, that's why I'm super classy, because I don't just drink tea out of a mug or a mason jar. I drink it out of a little glass with a tiny little handle on the paper with a tiny little spoon. And if that's set up then. Weird thing is, my fine china says it was made in Japan. My autobiography is going to be a chapter called Notes on Drugs. This chapter is going to be immediately followed by a chapter called Notes While on Drugs. Because I used to do drugs. And take notes while doing them. I look back at them thinking, when I thought that'd make good poetry. And No, it would not. Make a decent PSA. That's about When I drug test my employees, what that means is that I secretly dose the company coffee with acid and then take notes on how they work on them. I'm sorry, Dave. You're not tasting rainbows. In fact, you're on acid. I expected better than that. I'm sorry. Fuck, That DARE program back in high school really sucked. They should have switched it around and called it E-RAD, and maybe I was cut drugs instead of school. So that joke is one of my oldest jokes. Even though I was never in the DARE program, I don't remember how I came up with that joke. But I just remember it never worked. It seemed like all the kids with DARE t-shirts were the drug dealers.
Exactly!
I'm pretty sure some of them even got into the DARE program. That's cool. I'm pretty sure that some of them specifically got into that program so they could get the pencils and the t-shirts. I remember I did a show one time. It was in Bridgeport, Chicago, a tiny little venue, and I remember seeing the posting for it. And it just said, stand-up show, Summerfest. And I was like, oh boy, I'll apply for it. And I know the guy running it. And I called my buddy Matt up. I was like, hey, Matt, can I get in on that stand-up show? Because I do that. And he said, no, Ray, this is a kids to teen stand-up show. And I was like, oh, you should put that in the title. But okay, that's not me by a long shot. And then a couple weeks went by, and he called me up the day of the show and said, Ray, can you come down and do stand-up? We only have 2 kids signed up. I was like, yes, because I love attention, which is why I'm here now. And I went down there, I just grabbed all of my jokes. written full out with all my jokes and titles and all the words for each joke with like little categories and notes like cleaning for some audiences, and I didn't have enough time to go through and sort it out. So I was just like, I'll take them all and I'll figure it out when I get there. And I got there and I'm like, I was just kind of scanning through with me, and I've got like 5 jokes I can tell in front of this. And the opener was a guy called Thugnadian. I don't know if you're familiar with the Juggalos, but he looks. Juggalos, ICP, Insane Clown Posse, is like, they like to stylize themselves like a hardcore gangster band that wears scary clown makeup and loves Faygo soda and ugly parts of Michigan, like Detroit. I'm sorry, Detroit. They hype the bad part of Detroit. They're not from Detroit. Anyway. He looked like an ICP member. And he came out there, and I'm like, well, this is gonna be weird. And then he started doing all these like gangster rap songs, but it was all like just like silly things about Canada. And I was like, okay, well, I guess that's kid friendly. Until this last song, which was also kid friendly, but full of profanity, which was all about the Elizabeths, baby. And when he started doing it, I was like, cool, cool. Nice little spoof on All About the Benjamins. I think it's a decent spoof song. And then he's dropping all bombs. The F bombs, the S bombs, the B bombs, a few N bombs. I was like, white guy. Wow. What? And I was like, well, I guess I'll tell whenever I'm comfortable telling them. These kids have been exposed, if not before now. Holy smokes. And so I went up there and I just went through each page and I was like, ah, this joke, that joke. And I told a lot of them, but not most of them. I told about 18 jokes. I didn't want to be him. I was like, I don't want to go blue in front of little kids, because there were, in fact, 4-year-old kids in that audience. And it was kind of a... there was not a bunch of little white kids either. I was like, oh, white dude, I don't know what you think he's saying in front of these guys. I don't know if you're used to all white audiences where it's like a little white club and you think you're all safe, but... I hope these kids hate you. Their parents definitely would come off in like heat. I'm surprised none of them stopped you. They're a very polite audience. Anyway, I was doing my set and doing nothing but my silly jokes and keeping it clean. And at one point, I apologized because I went through 3 different pages line by line going, nope. And I explained this, I was going through like, I'm sorry, I'm doing something not blue. When I hear from the audience, go blue! I look out there, and there's a 12-year-old girl with like 3-foot-long curly red locks and a sunflower dress. Who yelled at me? She was just like sitting there like this, and And her dad's sitting next to her, and he's like, yeah, let's see what you got. And he was clearly a boxer. Shaved bald head, muscles like a bulldog were like rolled up onto his neck. Because we go blue tonight, and you'll understand the things that I've skipped over. Yeah, because I was like, okay, I'm not going to back down from a challenge. I'll take audience's requests, but at the same time, I'm going to tell some of these 12-year-old girls. Well, their dad looks like he could make you lie. Ooh, smokes. Come on in! Grab a seat. So finally, I found that dairy joke. And I was like, oh, you know what? That's just blue enough for me to feel comfortable telling in front of a kid. Your dad is like, hey, because I'm like saying drugs and I did on and be cool and whatever. But it's still not terrible. I'm still not dropping all the different bombs that Thugnadian did. Holy smokes. But told that joke, and I told a few more, and I said goodnight and thanks. And I was like, oh, geez, I hope it didn't show up any of the little kids inside of you. And the first one to walk up was a little girl in a sunflower dress, and she was like a Bill Hicks and Don Rickles. She made fun of her dad, she made fun of Rahm Emanuel, the president. She was up there for half an hour. At one point, she circled back around to my joke about the DARE program and turned my not even a minute long joke into a 15 minute set about stupid police and PSAs. And I was like, oh, I said, hey, good job. And she said, thanks, you're set. And then I saw her a year later at the same thing. And I said, hey, good to see you again, Kelly. You're great. And she said, I'm sorry, I don't remember you.
Over 21.
So the majority of these people at the house party looked like they're about 14. We're drinking the Tecate Light out of goblets with like emerald weed, not emerald gems, but emerald weeds that were probably encrusted in actual gold. So very nice goblets, which I had never seen before. I've seen goblets, I've never seen people use them. Like, yeah, I'm at a party, I bring my goblet. So I stuck around for a little while. I used to be a very antisocial person. I've been working against it for a long time. Been somewhat successful. But at the time I was very, very antisocial. I was just in new places as soon as I got there. And this one was a little more uncomfortable than most. So like, I think he invited me because he was like, hey guys, I got a white friend. Look at him. And I was like, cool. You know? That's cool, man. Look at me. Integrated. It's fun. After a couple of Tecate Lights, I was like, okay, well, I think I'll get out of here after one more. And as I'm making my way over to get one more Tecate Light, a dealer walks over to me. He's like, yo, Ray, man, don't be afraid, man. I'm like, I'm afraid. What am I shaking my boots? Yeah, I'm not afraid. He goes, don't worry, man. I got you back. I'm like, oh, I hope so. Your party at your house that you invited me to. He goes, don't worry, man, I got a knife in my sock. I'm like, sweet fucking shit. <Jesus. laughs> Oh no, I'm terrified. I didn't realize this was a prison yard. I thought it was a house party down the block. And I did not get one more Tecate. Gideon, I met him many years ago on the campus of Michigan State University. Gave me a little green Bible I found myself relying upon through the years when I run out of zigzags. Blasphemy! Once again, drugs. Don't rely on drugs. I mean, if you need drugs, maybe you should read a book. Take a walk, talk to someone, make new friends. Don't burn books. Never. Anyway, I used to live a very unhealthy lifestyle. Lots of coffee, lots of booze, different psychedelic drugs. No uppers or downers, I thought. Even though I smoked lots of cigarettes and booze, I was like, I'm not doing cocaine. Lots of things bad for me, and they probably added up to badness. So at one point in time, I needed a pacemaker. My heart might get to the near point of cracking out. The doctor might say, yeah, pacemaker, shock you back rather than have you come in here for the defibrillator. I said it. Anyway, I worked out an agreement with him. Where I'd have it engineered so it only works three times, and then the fourth time, instead of shocking me back from the grasp of death, the little speaker goes off and just goes. I've had my grandchildren at the time, but I have a grandpa! And someone explained that he was in a joke. Oh, he thought jokes were great all the time. Tell jokes whenever you can. Always a good time for jokes. Which reminds me of a joke I got talked out of. I almost went a little further in this joke. I will explain. By telling the joke, I love branding from the Nike swoosh on a pair of sneakers to a rancher's initials on a cow, which is why I have J. Drayton tattooed across my back, which I almost did at one point in time. I used to just tell that joke. It's a series of other different tattoo jokes. I don't know if you've caught the theme, but I tell my jokes in blocks of categories. Don't usually explain it. Yeah. Tell us the story here. So I thought, yeah, I've got all the So I get a great deal from the J. Dragon Tattoo Company if I went down there and had them tattoo their name on my back. I would tell my friend Brandon, who was helping me work on my stand-up act at the time, I'm like, wouldn't it be hilarious? I'll take my shirt off. I'm like, hi, ah, see you. I go, wait, you will get tired of this joke. Very possible one of the last sets that joke will ever work its way into. There was a giant tattoo company on my back. People are so confusing to people. This is like, so are you one of the workers? Or? No, I thought it was funny. That's why I also have this line drawing of a triangle, square, and circle. It's part of my tattoo joke about shapes. I got tired of that one way, way longer ago. Thanks, Brandon. So, a lot of people have a signature drink. A lot of people like beer, standard. A lot of people even just like cheap beer. I've run into a lot of people who like seem upset that there are a lot of people who like good beer or craft beer. Like, I don't know what's with craft beer bad. Dies to taste of drunkenness, which hopefully that goes away when I keep it just take a jacket or something and save your belly the beer trouble. Anyway, some people drink beer, some people drink wine, some people like champagne and stuff, or martini. Myself, I like a piece of Roma on the rocks with a splash of olive oil. Everything is a matter of taste. Does anyone here like strawberries? Well, I don't believe in taste, and you're wrong! They're disgusting! Do I have any Taoists in the audience tonight? No, damn it, thank you. Lottery, and I had lots of money, and I didn't have to do this. and I got to work hard at things that I love, like stand up and reading science fiction. I read all of that Elmore Leonard and William Gibson and Isaac Asimov. I read all of them. I own all of them, and I read all of them. And at one point, I published a terrible version of my own. But that's really just ludicrous, because I've never bought a lottery ticket, and I don't intend to ever buy a lottery ticket, because I'm actually decent at math. And I realize that that's a terrible investment. And I'd be way better off just putting $5 in a piggy bank. I mean, like, not even savings account, just put it right in a piggy bank. But I still imagine that. Because I think about gambling. I consider everything a gamble. And I usually look at things that take money to gamble for money as a bad gamble. You probably wouldn't be making that offer if they didn't think they were going to get your money. So I don't usually gamble on that. I'll gamble on things like, I think I'll make this yellow light, or STDs. So, everyone needs hobbies. I've got a hobby. I like to masturbate to pedestrians. From my window, where no one can see me. It's Raymond Jim Walker. Don't do that. I used to just tell that joke and think, like, that's silly. But I heard a lot of stuff. A lot of stuff online. I was like, holy smokes. That's probably a genre. There is probably an entire community of people that can only do that. Like, they've got a girlfriend, she's like, why can't you get off? And I'm like, could you just walk outside and pretend I can't see you? But that is gross. Really, I have different hobbies. Work on stand-up. Sometimes in my spare time, I'll have to go to abortion rallies. I don't pick sides or anything like that. I just like to watch them from a distant hill with a fine punch like an aristocrat in the Civil War. Little hobbies. I like telling jokes. There's some jokes I have in reserve, like tattoo jokes. I mean, they're jokes that are way out of my canon. Jokes that I don't tell unless the circumstance fits it and it calls upon them, and I remember, like, hey, that's a joke I wrote in the room. Sometimes I'm reading right out of the spot. Like the sauerkraut joke. I can remember writing that joke during an open mic when there were 8 comics going, come on, everyone! Come on! It's a room full of comics, dude. It's 1 AM, we're all comedians. I can't believe there are 8 people doing this. All of you were the people not applauding for the other people. You think you're the only one that deserves it? Jesus Christ. But then I went out there and told that joke, and no one laughed at that. Been doing this for a long time because a lot of my high school friends started having kids right out of high school. And so there's one that I was like, oh, this is hilarious. I'll do this every time I hear someone say, I'm having a baby. I jump in and say, stuff to nothing. They don't like it. But I still do. So we used to work in construction. I still somewhat work in construction, but that's beside the point. Anyway, at one point in time, I was working with a plumber, and we had gone to this kitchen that he'd worked at a million different times before, and it was clogged because he kept pouring the grease down the drain, and he knew exactly how to rot it, to get the rot in there, to knock the grease out, and make it fine. And you whip the rod in. Boom, hit it, got it off. You go, see that? Jeez, no, it's just like fucking your old lady. Get in there, hit the spot, and go to sleep. Holy shit. I just hope that you use that metaphor in reverse when you're actually fucking your old lady. You know, yeah, it's just like robbing a black sewer drain. Whip the snake in there, knock the shit out, get paid. So, yeah, I used to work construction, and I still do heavy labor. I used to do crazy construction. I was the ditch digging machine. A long time ago, I injured my back real bad, really very bad. Kind of bad, where I just woke up and went, "Gah!" And then called in from bed. And so I saw my doc the day after that, and he told me, "Ready, you're fat and need no job." So yes, work in construction. Especially in Chicago, I don't know about other places around the world, but especially Chicago, mostly a bunch of white guys. Mostly a bunch of middle-aged white men. And I don't know if you noticed, but I'm actually a white man myself. While not middle-aged, that doesn't matter. As far as they're concerned, it's white man club to them, and it's time for the secret white man discussion group. And I'm like, hey, let's all agree on this stuff together. And if you don't, it's time for you to learn. And I was like, hey, guys, that's not cool. Looked wrong. I like try to explain logically. Like, you see, that doesn't make sense. It doesn't like this. And they would just look at me like, poor retarded Ray. One of these days, we're going to have to shoot you. And so that was fun. If you think about it, which I did a lot because I did that for a long time, and I think of crazy hypothetical things. Like, well, what if, hypothetically speaking, you were to judge someone by the color of their skin? What if this was a good thing to judge someone by, hypothetically speaking? Then you should not trust a white, because they've got a terrible track record. Actually, the worst. I don't know if you're paying attention or not, white man, but you guys are terrible. I mean, just listen to you right now. Jesus Christ. It also involved a lot of classic rock music. I don't want to get into that, because it's terrible. Misogynistic nonsense too. And there's a thing I started doing, you guys can do it too, if you have to deal with this kind of thing. I'll just give you a little example of how it's done. Someone will say something terrible, and then you give them like this weird extended Ed McMahon response. Because at first they'll think like, hey, yeah, thanks, I'm Johnny Carson. And then they realize that they're being harpooned, or they think you're crazy. Either way, they'll shut up. So we'll use a verbatim example. So the guy was saying this. And then all that works like that. You don't understand how it goes. So anyway, Ray, I get home the other night, and I walk into the bedroom. I just get back from the shower. My wife's waiting for me naked out of the bed on her hands and knees, right? And she goes, hey, do you want to have sex? And I said, I just got out of the shower. She's like, you don't want me to get you dirty? I'm like, no. And so I said, hello. They want the money from you and from their customers, they're gonna be tough. And I thought about money from them, I had to be tough to do. One day, I was like, I worked here long enough and hard enough, I want a raise. So I put together a plan, walked into his office one morning and said, hey, boss, I want a raise. Or a blowjob. I got a raise. Then he's got to give them options. But it was a raise. It was a raise. It was nice. It wasn't a big raise. And I still dream. I dream about making all that money and doing what I want. And I'm pretty sure that the way to make lots of money and still have a little fun is to rip someone off. Rip off a song, a movie, something. Rip someone something off. And I want it to be big time. I don't want to just rip off one song or one movie or a book. I'm going to rip off an entire genre, which is why I plan on opening up a music studio, calling it Wootown Records. I'm going to hire a president, get him to change his name to Bari Gari. We'll have hit artists like Smokey Robinson, Sam and Dave and Bob. Instead of flat tracks on our records, we'll have hoof claps. Mickey's monkey. Please, so let me make it sad in here for a moment. One morning I was on my way to work and I stopped because I saw a dog. I don't know if the dog had been hit by a car or just mistreated or had some kind of disease, but it looked very bad, very sad. So I picked it up, called in to work, I was going to be late. I didn't explain that I'd taken care of the dog, it's not possible. Jesus Christ, kill the dog! Run it over! Put it on your way! What? So anyway, I picked it up, and I went to a vet, and the vet didn't help at all. As a matter of fact, the whole time I was there, all the vet did was talk about Agent Orange and Vietnam. I was like, oh, the dog! The vets are worthless! Ah, oh, stupid! I've heard from a lot of people that strangers sometimes will just touch their hair. I've heard this for a long time from different speakers and different people, and I've experienced it myself. And the way it happens for me, it's all right, because it's still invasive and I don't like it, but when I tell the people what makes my hair do this, they feel bad about what they just did. What happens is, when I work really hard in like a dirty environment, I get anime hair that just sticks out all over this place, shooting out spikes. And people think, well, what kind of moose does he use? It looks so, I can just stick my fingers right in there. What is this? I say, it's dirt and sweat. And they go, oh. And I'm like, yeah, you should feel terrible. For more than just that reason, but I'm glad you feel a little gross. Anyway, if this happens for any of you or any of your friends, I recommend you go a little further than me. Because, I mean, that one, you might feel a little gross. And this one, you'll feel a little gross. But trust me, oh, the look on their face is going to be worth it. When they stick their hands in your hair, and they go, oh, what is this? Or like, oh, you're feeling hairy. You just go, I have lice. Because they are going to cut their hand off if they have a lice. You say gross, I assume you're talking about people sticking their hands in your hair, not lice. I'm sticking my hand in someone's hair. Is this, who are you? What is this?
Girl, yeah.
Exactly, precisely. So I'm a genius. Super high IQ. So high that it rates low because I don't study on books. One of those guys that's too concerned with my super fancy brain to study books. Anyway, I'm a genius. Don't mind the fault in that logic, genius, right here. And so in my spare time, I try and work on things that will improve humanity. I try to just figure out ways to make humanity safer and better. One of the things I've been working on is an eject seat for helicopters. But I haven't got the timing quite right yet. So I am a genius. I am working on many different things. I think they make humanity a better people, better world. My latest invention, which I believe will be a true success and not a people shredder, is an air freshener. You see, most air fresheners aim to eliminate or just cover up the smell of your poop. And they're either too strong or don't work. And their fault is the elimination. Mine does not seek to eliminate the smell of your poop. Mine aims to complement the smell of your poop. Before you know it, people will be saying, did you just poop? So I used to be addicted to the internet. This lasted just a few years. It's what I did instead of studying at college. And you might think yourself addicted to the internet. Pornography, well, that certainly played a heavy hand. That's not all of it. Not even close to all of it. Because addicted to the internet, that's the majority of your day. And that is a lot of nonsense. Like, at one point in time, I remember I read an encyclopedia on the X-Men. An article, pages of articles on each individual character in alternate timelines of the mutants from the X-Men in the Marvel Universe. I didn't even read the comic books. I know all of their stories and plot lines. Ridiculous! At one point in time, one day, I was cruising the Internet Movie Database, imdb.com. And I was checking out the film history of George Lent. I was like, what has he done that I haven't seen? I like this stuff. Like that. It was good. Good show. Good movie. And I came upon this movie that I'd never seen before, called Hostage for a Day. And I checked it out because it was directed by John Candy, star George Lent. I was like, hey! I think I remember seeing this title in the old VHS rental store I used to go to as a kid. Like, tied up some dynamite around the wall. And so I read the summary, which was just like, man pretends to take himself for hostage for a holiday. I was like, okay, well, that does sound banal. Let's read the review. And there was one review at the time. At the time, there was only one person who reviewed it. And it was so mean. It was ridiculously mean. I still haven't seen the movie, but it was way too mean. It placed all the blame on George Mike for the movie not being funny. And I was like, he's an actor. He did not write this script. He didn't even direct it. Just because there was even a part of the review that went out of its way of saying, like, I don't know why John Candy's name is attached to this thing. Because he directed it! He should be to blame for part of it, a large part of this! If it was a success, he'd be taking the success for it. And I really thought that was unfair. So what I did was I found the most glowing review of The Godfather I could find. Changed it around and read Hostage for a Day and posted that puppy up there. So if you look it up, you can find it. Hostage for a Day, reviewed by Yumo Mimo. Quite possibly John Candy's opus. I shouldn't really feel bad about plagiarizing that review, though. I should have written my own kind of odd review. If I had to do it all over again, I would be furious. I would be completely upset. I refuse to do anything. I'm not doing this. Who's signing up for this? I do this. You fucked. So there's a new movie coming out. It's a sequel. They're making The Fugitive 2. They got what's his name back? Han Solo. He's already a hashtag too old. He'll die soon. Yes, he doesn't deserve a real name. Han Solo reprising his role as the fugitive in The Fugitive 2. This time, Dr. Kimball's back. He's remarried. He's cleared of the original crime. when his new wife is murdered. And he's praying for this one too. And he's arrested and blamed for it too, and he's screaming, "I didn't do it! It was an unarmed man! He had no arms!" Because I gotta up the ante. So, have you guys heard the one about the agnostic and the Loch Ness Monster?
No.
You know, I don't actually think it's a real joke. So at one point in time, I was working in a school, hanging lights in the library. An entire class full of students came in. Second graders, I believe, or something like that. The kids just look like little kids. Once they're above 4 feet tall, like, I don't know, older than third grade, maybe? Anyway, little kids, led by the teacher to look for books. Some kind of question, and I couldn't hear it. It was all mumbly and shy, and the teacher didn't hear it either. And the teacher said, "What it is?" And I turned around and said, "Hey, that's a book by Stephen King about a giant clown spider that likes to scare children in four days." And she said, "It's architecture." My mom told me, she was cold, and so I said, "Hey, Mom, you should get yourself a concealed weapon permit and start carrying around a gun so you're back in heat." My mom never said that. She did grow up with a lot of sayings, so she used to have a lot of old sayings that were very good, and I think her name is a nice human being despite the jokes I've been saying tonight. I'll share some of them with you, and hopefully you guys can grow some things. So my mom used to say, "Raymond, when you assume something, you're a fucking asshole." My mom used to say, "Raymond, when God closes a door, he opens a window for you to jump out of it and kill yourself, you're worthless." She never said that. Smelliest, not just places, but things. It's one of the smelliest things in existence. It's so incredibly bad smelling, you'll smell it from miles away. You know, I took a different highway route to try and avoid that city, and it still permeated my car. Which is why it's one of my standards for bad smells. I'll walk into a bathroom after someone else and go, "Woo! It smells like Gary in the Inn!" And I'm like, "Oh, jeez! What a match in that city!" So, I am a classically trained actor. I know it's obvious. Shakespeare, all that stuff that's involved in being a classically trained actor, because I am. And you too can be a classically trained actor like me by following my easy three-step program. Step one, pose. Step two, take your shirt off. That's the opposite. Yeah, my dad's name Tony. coming from. So where this song is just about things that I love. The song used to have a longer title to explain all the things that I love, but instead now it's just called the Bates Motel. So what the song used to be called was I Love Raffy Stab Jacks and Hitch. Because that's what the song's about. Down by the Bates Motel, back to my home I dare not go, for if I do, my mother will say, I should go off if you were young, shouldn't have had a potion. Down by the Bates Motel, back to my home I dare not go, for if I do, my mother will say, wanna put your way in, no more, you know I know what to do in the room, your bastards on this fucking stage, dead girls, why don't you be in suspect?
I saw punk rock and I was like, oh boy, I like this and it's cool. I had drunk a lot of beer. And so I had to go to the house to use the bathroom. And I walk in there, and I'm pretty sure I spot the bathroom because it's the only room that's like a kitchen, and there's a line of people in front of the door. I'm like, that's got to be the bathroom. And I say, is this the bathroom? And like three people are like, yeah. And three other people are like, no. I was like, okay, are you guys all in line? And three people like just raised their hand. I'm like, okay, so I'm gonna get behind you guys. And the three other people, I guess, were just hanging out in the kitchen with the people waiting in line for the bathroom. And one of the guys just hanging out on the kitchen counter says to me, he goes, hey, if you gotta pee real bad, I can just go outside and pee in my mouth. I said, oh, well, I don't think I'd be able to work up the courage to do that. One of the guys in front of me, I'm like, turns around and goes, the courage? I'm like, oh, yeah, I know. Kind of got a shy letter. So I didn't want to sound lame. I already looked enough like a cop. So that happened. Let's talk about politics. I don't like them. And politicians know this too. Because I assume most people don't like politics. And politicians know this. And instead of just becoming different people and being better politicians, they just claim to not be politicians. They say, I'm a Washington outsider. Which I think is strange, because that's your job, sir. If you were good at this, you'd be a Washington insider. You know the ins and the outs of it. If I need my boots repaired and I went to a cobbler and I said, I'm not even a cobbler. You won't find me in this shop. I'm across the street at the bar. Only time I come into this shop is to stop the one guy who does try to cobble shoes. I won't let him. That's the guy I love working on my boots. So, first time I voted for Ralph Nader. Because I am a big supporter of the name Ralph. I can hear it way more often. I did vote for Ralph Nader because I thought that James Earl Jones would be doing voiceovers for the old one. It was part of hearing that. Nader, apparently. You've got to be out of your mind to ever consider using nuclear weapons. Unless, of course, you're in a room full of people who say that you should. Right? We all agree in this room? Well, I don't see any reason why we shouldn't. That sounds like a good idea. Sarah Palin. Sarah. Come on, Sarah. China. China. Come on, China. Enough politics. Oh, wait. One more political joke. Oh, I shouldn't have been introduced to this. Too late now. I have jokes in the back, left and right, like I'm a murderer. Wait, no, I'm not. Confidence in front of the audience. I'm killing it tonight. You're welcome, audience. So, the mayor of Chicago, Ron Emanuel, not many people know this about him, but in the spare time, what he likes to do is go around fighting crime and sidekick a monkey named Noodles. Chief police is always jumping in at the end and going, you've saved the day again, Ramen Noodles! Some people refer to bathrooms as lavatories. It's another name for them. It's just kind of a weird name. Makes me think that there's a Nobel Prize for soap and water. That's how it plays in my head. People do refer to bathrooms as lavatories. And I don't know about you, but I don't want some scientists barging in on me while I'm taking a All right, enough lavatory and political category
horrible jokes. Kind of get on to the meat of the show, milk jokes. I know you might have expected meat jokes, but I don't actually have any of those. So, milk jokes. My milk went bad about 3 months ago, but I still have it in my fridge, because I believe in second chances. I don't cry over spilt milk. I take my belt to it. Otherwise, I'll never learn. Alright, this is not a joke. A bartender walks into a bar, and the bartenders say, "What'll you have?" So this one is a joke. A horse walks into the bar, first shot, and the barber says, "What can I do for you?" And the horse pulls out a gun and says, "The money, motherfucker!" I said, "The fucking money! You think this is a joke?" That is a joke. It also was part of my bar joke category, which now transitions over to horse jokes. So I bought a horse-drawn cart. Not the best portrait ever, but I like it. Definition of easily. The definition of easily is easel-like. Yes. I hate the KKK, I hate it a lot, which is why I always order my veal well done. Don't think about it. Don't think about it. Think about this one. This joke makes sense. VFW, Veterans of Foreign Wars. What do those jerks have against Civil War survivors? Bastards. Bastard jerks. It's a running joke. I recently got a cup of coffee at a Dunkin' Donuts, and I got a receipt for the coffee, and the clerk pointed at the receipt and said, "Hey, would you like to give us some feedback?" And I said, "Knock, knock. Who's there? Detective! Detective who? Detective Peterson! Now open the door! I have a warrant to search the premises! You're not taking me alive, copper! I wouldn't have it in your way, scumbag!" Oh, you got me! You got me, stick of pig! See you in hell. Tell that to your kids. Another good thing to do is when the kids do start telling knock-knock jokes, even that one, if they're able to learn that one, like if it clicks in their head, because they probably won't just go before it. But other ones, if they can tell other ones, because this is the starter. At one point in time, all people like to tell jokes. It wears off at some point in time, and then only freaks who love attention are going to be telling it jokes. But at one point in time, everyone's telling jokes. And it starts with knock-knock jokes. When your kids start telling them, you're getting bored of them, stomp them like this. And they go, "Knock, knock, just say, come on in, the door's open. How you doing, you old son of a gun?" And they'll get So I heard a story in the news years ago. And the headline was all over different channels. And the headline was the same in every news agency. It said, "Victim turns tables on rapist." I was like, holy shit. What? And I looked into it. And it turns out that what happened was the lady beat this guy up. And I was like, oh, okay. Because I was expecting that story to end with a strap on. Put a cardboard sign up on a tree that said, "Pick up your dog's crap." Actually, I had an exclamation point, so it read, "Pick up your dog's crap!" So I put one above it that said, "Take down your cardboard sign." Sign jokes. That's what I have. Right now, I like the places that have signs that say, "We reserve the right to refuse service for any reason." Because I think to myself, like, they must have had a short list at some point in time. And then people just kept going in, like, weird directions. And they're like, all right, anything. We will kick you out of here whenever we feel like it.
So whenever I see one of those, I'm always thinking to myself, like, what could I do? It's not technically illegal or like known to be offensive. We're going to be like, oh, I didn't know that wasn't allowed. And we're going to push that limit. Mm-mm. What if I started as pantomime stripping? I'll have the Mongolian beef. Asada. Crab rangoons. And 2 liter of crush. What do you mean? I'm only beef. Explain that to the police.
Oh, you have a camera.
Last joke about signs.
I know you were just getting into it and wanted to. I'm afraid it's the last one.
Been seeing a lot of signs around town that say coin laundry. What I want to know is who's washing their coins? Ludicrous. And so we find ourselves at the end of the show, and we'll leave you with a little thing that I worked out a long time ago. I'd like to offer my thanks to Chicago for helping me work this one up. Because when I first moved to Chicago, I had my car broken into 5 times in a year, and they took my stereo twice. No bad stereos, too. The first one was missing 5 buttons. It was a stock radio missing buttons, and they took it. They took the crap one and put it after that, too. So anyway, I went a long time without a radio because it's like, well, I'm just going to leave a gaping hole in my car. Because it's not breaking in. Like, when they see that, they're just like, someone got it and moving on to the next car. That's done. So I just left a big gaping hole in there for a long time. And for a long time, I did not come up with a solution of just bringing a jam box with me, playing a jukebox on my radio. My car, radio in my car. Nah, I'll edit this out later. Or maybe not. Anyway, before I figured out that I could just bring in tunes, not in radio form, I did a lot of driving without radio. And that's fine for short periods of time. But when you're on the road for 4 hours by yourself driving at night, that's where you start reaching the dangerous, crazy proportions. At some point in time, I just started singing all the songs that I had memorized. I didn't even know I had this many songs memorized. I got a decent number of songs verbatim in my head. And I got sick of those songs within an hour. And at one point in time, out of nowhere, I just started impersonating Don Pardo. I was like, yeah, I do a pretty decent Don Pardo. What else can I do with this? How about I sing some of my songs that I know is not Mario? And so, I will warm up a little bit, and then I will deliver for you guys the end of the show.
It's Saturday Night Live with your host, Mr. Alec Baldwin, and your musical guest, me, Don Pardo. I've been rolling down the street, smoking endo, sipping on gin juice, the laid back, with my mind on my money, and my money on my mind. I got me some Seagram's gin, everyone's got a cup, but they chipped in, you know. This type of shit happens all the time, getting yours before I get mine. So what you want to do? I've got a pocket full of rubbers, and my homeboys do too. So turn off the lights and close the doors. But what? We don't have them whores. And we're gonna smoke an ounce to that. Jesus, down like you motherfuckers. Bounce to that. Whoa. Cause I've been rolling down the street. my mind on my money, and my money on my mind.
Yeah, that's a challenge.